right, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the regular business meeting of Reading City Council here on Monday, December 9th. We are going to open this evening's meeting with the invocation by Zach Bougay from the Reading Conference of Churches. And we will remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Thank you. God of justice and mercy, thank you for the gift of life and the opportunity to serve the people of Reading, Pennsylvania. Help us to act with character and conviction. Help us to listen with understanding and goodwill. Help us to speak with charity and restraint. Give us a spirit of service. Remind us that we are stewards of your authority. Guide us to be the leaders your people need. Help us see the humanity and dignity of those who disagree with us, and to treat all persons, no matter what the situation they are presented with the reverence your creation deserves. Father, renew us with the strength of your perseverance and the joy of helping to build a community not just worthy of the human person, but one you desire to provide us. Lord, Romans 13:1 reads, "Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which is given, except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God." Lord, I pray for these leaders that are standing before us today, Lord God, that they've been given to us, Lord, for the great city of Reading, Pennsylvania, a city with a valuable purpose. Give them your wisdom, your discernment, Lord, as that will be imperative for the city of Reading to reach the destiny and purpose that you have for this great city, Lord. Make them aware of how special and important each and every one of them are. Father, we ask this as your sons and daughters, confident in your goodness and love. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Here.
Ms. Gubin-Hinderschitz?
Here.
Mr. Marmaru?
Here.
Ms. Reed?
Here.
Ms. Sahelnik?
Here.
Mr. Twyman?
Present.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Here.
7 present, none absent.
All right. Okay. Real quickly, we had executive sessions, closed session on December 2nd, fact-finding, executive session on December 2nd and December 9th related to contracts, litigation, and personnel related, relevant to the Pennsylvania Sunshine Act, Section 108, 1, 8, and 4, if I read that correctly. All right. We have no proclamations or presentations this evening, Council. We do have 4 speakers. 3 of them are on non-agenda items. Is there any objection to hearing from all of them at this time? If not, I'm going to ask that Councilwoman Reed please read our public comment guidelines.
Faster than I am, Jeff. Okay. Thank you, Mr. President. The Administrative Code, Section 5-209, defines public participation at council meetings. Citizens attending council meetings are expected to conduct themselves in a responsible and respectful manner that does not disrupt the meeting. Those wishing to have conversation should do so in a hallway outside council chambers in a low speaking voice. Public comment will occur only during the public comment period, and all public comment must be directed to council's body and not to any individual council member or public or elected official in attendance. Clapping, calling out, and/or cheering when a speaker finishes his comments is not permitted. Citizens may not approach the council tables at any time during the meeting. All comments should be made from the podium. If you have materials to disperse to council, please give them to our auditor, Maria Rodriguez, and she will pass them along. Any person making threats of any type, personally offensive or impertinent remarks, or any person becoming unruly while addressing council may be called to order by the presiding officer and may be barred from speaking, removed from council chambers, and or cited. Those speaking on agenda items have 5 minutes, on non-agenda items, 3 minutes.
All right, thank you, Donna. Our first speaker this evening is, Jose Figueroa? Yep, and the topic is importance of, I can't read that writing. Sir, what's your topic?
The census, the upcoming 2020 census.
Oh, okay, I can't read that. All right, sir, you're on a non-agenda item. I'm suspecting you need a little more than 3 minutes.
I could do it in five, if that's all right.
Counselor, is there any objection to that?
No.
All right, we'll let you move forward.
Thank you. I just made a trek over from Philadelphia to be here, so Council President and members of Council, it's a pleasure to be here. And the information that you have in front of you, and hopefully there are enough copies for everyone, is with regard to the upcoming 2020 census and the importance of the same. And basically, three messages: the importance of educating folks on the importance, engaging them in order for them to understand how their participation impacts Berks directly and Reading City directly, and then also motivating them to respond. So in your packet, you have some information with regard to confidentiality. And what is important about that is when we talk about the census and it being safe, important, and easy, that safe piece is very important, especially in the political climate that we just went through over the summertime with the citizenship question. And even though that is behind us, there are some concerns that folks have about the census being safe for them. And what's important to mention is that when we say that it is safe and that we keep your information private and confidential, it's not that we're nice people and we're willing to do that. Rather, Title 13 of the US Code states that it is written into the law that the information that we collect cannot be shared with anyone. In fact, the Supreme Court in 1982 even confirmed that addresses are to be maintained confidential. So not only the individual responses that are provided, but also even addresses. And then a little further in 2010, the Justice Department even confirmed that the Patriot Act cannot override the information that we collect. The only thing that can be made public is the aggregate information of everyone's information together, and no one's individual responses are shared with anyone. So the second point about it being important, nearly $675 billion annually are redistributed back to the states based on the population count. So in order to ensure that each state and therefore each county and each city receives their fair share of the taxes that are collected, it is important for folks to understand that their participation in fact affects formula-based funding. So whether it's nonprofit organizations that are submitting grants and are using data to substantiate their request for funds, or municipalities that are receiving dollars back for infrastructure, for emergency, for road improvements, for whatever it might be, that the count is complete and accurate. And businesses use it as well with regard to either planning where their workforce is going to come from in order to move or open up a second location or to develop their marketing strategy. And then that last piece about motivating people to respond in March 12th or so is when folks will begin to receive the invitation to self-enumerate. And what's important is for folks to understand that timeline. April 1st is what we call Census Day, and that's when we need to honor about April 1st, count the nearly 330 million people that are throughout the country. But it's important for folks to be motivated already by March 12th, when the invitation to participate comes out to their homes, so that they will then self-select to enumerate. For the first time ever, we're offering the opportunity for folks to self-respond via the internet. That's one option. The second option would be to call a toll-free number to provide their information over the phone. And then the third option is that there will still be the traditional paper questionnaire that will be sent out to homes that require that. And if they're not able to participate through one of those three means, then later in the spring of 2020, we'll be sending out the enumerators, the door knockers that would go door to door in order to then collect the information for those households. So important, again, because of the political representation, because of this, the disbursement of funds back to states, the counties, and local municipalities. Easy because of the multiple ways that folks can respond. And then safe because it is written into the law that the information that is received cannot be shared with anyone. The last thing that I want to say is that we're also hiring. There is a local Reading area census office, and we do have local jobs that are in the office, but the bulk of the jobs are going to be those enumerators that would go door to door. In order to get more information about the jobs, individuals can go to 2020census.gov/jobs. Thank you. So you have some information here that talks about the importance and the upcoming decennial. And I thank you for your time. I don't know if there are any questions or time for questions.
We don't normally have interaction, but if you have a brief comment.
I do, and thank you for coming here. I serve on this the Complete Count Committee for Census 2020 here in Berks County. And dovetailing with everything you've discussed, we have many subcommittees, many groups that will be doing a serious outreach. Many community groups, our colleges, our school districts, our social service agencies. So it really is a major effort that we're hoping to preclude the 16,000 undercount we had, the estimated undercount in 2010. We did speak today, we had a meeting of our government subcommittee today, and I serve along with Tammy Davis Coleman as the city representatives on that we will be doing a rollout. I don't know if it'll be the 20 days of Census 2020, because that would start March 13th through April 1st, but we will be doing community events throughout Berks County to provide internet access for people, to do the online responses, particularly here in the city and the urban core. The surrounding municipalities will be working together. So I know we'll be working with you, and I believe our newest partnership specialist here in Berks County.
She is here. Corey Nelson is in the back.
Corey, yes. I heard about you today. Nice to see you. And you're serving Berks and Schuylkill County, correct? And you're from Cymru, so you're a Berks County person. So we look forward to working with you and Isabel and everyone else. We've started very early on our Complete Count Committee process, and I know we've been working and helping other communities with that process. We had a very successful Complete Count process in 2000 and in 2010. We're looking to make it far more extensive this year. We have gotten good funding from the county, from the Berks County Community Foundation, Why Missing Foundation, and others. So we appreciate your coming here, and we really want to make it a point to all our city residents, and you touched on a lot of good things with political climate and concerns about confidentiality, but the more everyone counts, the more really critical funding comes, not just to Reading, but all Berks County and our municipalities for, I think it's 134 different programs, is it something like that?
Depends on who you ask. Yes, there are about 134 major federal programs, correct.
And it represents per person per year, $1,200 or $2,100.
So the Pennsylvania Statewide Complete Count Commission with the Pennsylvania State Data Center, their estimate is $2,093 per person that comes back according to the 2015 numbers. $2,093 according to the Pennsylvania Statewide Complete Count Commission, Governor Wolf's office.
And that's per person per year?
Yes, to the states.
Great. Well, thank you very much for coming here.
My pleasure.
I think it's something we'll all be working together as a council and administration.
Yeah, and I think a municipal Complete Count Committee, I think, would be awesome.
Yeah, we're well established, so we'd love to interact with you. So. Please feel free to, and Corey, you'll be interacting a lot with us, so we look forward to working with you.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, sir.
Take care.
All right, our next speaker this evening is Jose Vidal, and the topic is Mayor Fine. Good evening, Jose. It's a non-agenda item, so you have up to 3 minutes, okay?
Perfect, thank you. Good evening, gentlemen. It came to our attention that Mayor Wally Scott basically got sanctioned. You guys gave him a summons for an appearance that a political candidate from the Dominican Republic made to the city of Reading. There was a misinterpretation from the information you guys got and basically the Dominican community. When Ramfis Trujillo visited this whole room on the 12th of May of last year. It wasn't a political event, and Mayor Wally Scott didn't politicize that event. Now, the community as a whole basically knew that it was like honoring the Dominican community, and it wasn't a political event. Now, Ramphis is running for president of the Dominican Republic, and I have a letter here signed by him expressing that it was not a political event. It was in honor of the Dominican community and the service that they have done for the city of Reading. You guys might want to take a look at this. And in my possession here, I also have letters from members of various different groups in Reading that basically understands that it wasn't a political event. Maybe you guys, before you guys made the decision to sanction them, I guess we didn't have a voice, we didn't know that it was going on, but even though it might be too late, I just want you guys to take a look at this and at least see if there's any way to reverse that sanction, or is there anything else we could do? And trust me, I'm not a Democrat. I'm actually a Republican. I work for the Department of Justice. I'm agent 6722 of the, I work as a foreign agent. So when we had the event in this hall, I made sure that it wasn't a political event. It was basically an event for the community. So I just want you guys to take a look at this too. And that's all I have to say about that right now.
All right, thank you. We'll have an opportunity to respond briefly at the end of our comment period. Our next speaker is Cesar Villamor, and the topic is Mayor Fine. Good evening, Cesar. It's a non-agenda item, so you have up to 3 minutes.
Okay, thank you everyone. And I would like to say the same. You know, it wasn't a political event. It was something for the community, for the Dominican community. Our intention was present to everyone what the Dominican community do for this city. I think it's not fair that, you know, they give it a sanction or whatever to Wally Scott, and I don't know who say that there was a political event, and that's not true. We're here, and we want to. That's all I want to say. You know, we want to prove, and we have to prove that we wasn't a political activity. That's all I had to say.
Thank you. Thank you. Our final speaker this evening is Reverend Evelyn Morrison, and the topic is agenda item B-39, 50, 64, 105, and 110 resolution. I'm not sure exactly where they are. I see it. Yep. Okay. Good evening, Evelyn. You have up to 5 minutes.
Good evening, President of Council, Council members, Auditor, and the community. I'm here, and I'll be brief on each subject because it's important that we do have a voice on these issues. When we look at the housing and blighted strategy, we have to make sure that the people who are occupying the blighted properties are given an opportunity to have access to the community development public funds in order to rehab their properties without the loss of the right to their property. The other thing is, and that was Bill 39. Bill, this one doesn't have a number that's listed, but it's about the ordinance, the zoning ordinance being reviewed so that we can initiate high-rise apartments, expanding those opportunities for redevelopment in the city. That's all well and good, but the concern is two things, especially as this ties in with the purchase of the 50 acres of the Dana property. The policies need to be expounded in that we have disclosures for the end user. When people purchase a townhouse, an apartment, rental, and it's been built on a former brownfields property, it's only right that we have a policy in place to identify and disclose the, like we do in housing. HUD has a lead disclosure, a mold disclosure, a radon disclosure, any hazard disclosure to the public. Well, I believe that we need to have a former brownfields or a redevelopment brownfields disclosure so that people, the end user, knows that this was a contaminated property that was remediated and or it still is. And the danger to public health may or may not exist. I think people, if they're buying a property or renting a property, need to have that. So we're working with the Human Relations Commission. We've been appointed to be on their advisory council, and we're going to be working with them in their policy department to create this disclosure. We also reached out to HUD, and they're very much in favor of looking at that overall process. So we're hoping that in 2020, we will have a policy in place. Let me move on. When we look at the the charter board does a lot of things, but lately it's been really busy, and I know that there's some conflict there as well. But the charter board needs to do more education in the community and with our public officials, because there's a lot of people that have misnomers and misunderstanding of the charter itself. And then when we look at the charter, we have to realize that the citizens are the power in any government. And when you designed your organizational structure, and I saw it, that goes with the budget, I asked you one question. Where are the citizens in your organizational structure? They're missing. I hope that's not an oversight, or I hope that's not the philosophy of council, that the citizens are not there. They should be at the top of the organizational structure, as per the U.S. Constitution, as per the state constitution, and as per the local charter. The last thing is about the dams, the contaminated dams, especially Bernhardt Dam. We've been talking to you about it for almost 3 years now, that these are contaminated sites. Now you have to deal with them. And you have to deal with them very carefully, because when you disturb the powders of sediment, you're going to create an effect, a negative effect in the air. So the people who live around those properties, they have to be careful that they're not going to become, it's not going to become a hazard to their health. And I would get a health screening at this point, so that they would be able to have a measurement whether or not living around those contaminated sites have affected their health. We have 300 families that are documented due to cancer that lived and grew up in the Buttonwood Street Gateway near American Chain and Cable. And now we're reaching a bell curve in terms of the types of cancers that the health department has identified directly related to contaminants. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Evelyn. That concludes our speakers for this evening. Council, we're going to move on to the approval of our agenda and minutes. Oh, I'm sorry. We do have an opportunity for brief comments at this point to any of the speakers. Again, if somebody comments and states what you want to state, we can save it till later on as well. Did you have a comment, Marcia?
Yeah, I just wanted to clarify to the two speakers that spoke about the whole issue of the Dominican rally. Council made took no action. It was not in our purview. That was not something that we did any kind of resolution on. It's real important to note that. I believe it went through the ethics board.
Correct.
Okay. so that would be the body that would need to hear the information. There's nothing that we did to take action on that as a council.
All right, are there any other comments that need to be expressed at this time? All right, if not, I'm going to move on to the approval of our agenda and our minutes. The minutes are from our November 25th, 2019 regular meeting, and approving the summations of the discussions from the November 25th and December 2nd Committee of the Whole meetings. With the approval of our agenda, we will also approve the following consent agenda items. The first is an award of a contract. The purchase of a Telemax hybrid EOD robot to Telerob USA in Erie, Pennsylvania. The total project cost is $261,905. The County of Berks has signed a memorandum of understanding to fund $100,000 of this purchase. The remaining $161,905 will be funded out of our capital project budget. The next item is an award of contract for the purchase of a real-time crime-fighting software, StreetSmart software platform to StreetSmart LLC in El Segundo, California. The total project cost over 3 years is $52,050. The police department has confirmed there are sufficient funds to cover the project, which will be funded by a DCED and DOJ JAG grant in 2020 and a DOJ JAG grants in 2021 and 2022. Another item under our consent agenda is a resolution authorizing the disposal of contract documents from the city clerk's office in accordance with the Pennsylvania record retention policy as specified below. And the fourth item is a resolution we're going to move to our regular resolution agenda, so we'll defer. We will move that to resolutions and cover that at that time. Is there any objection to the approval of the agenda, minutes, and consent agenda items? If there's no objection, they will stand as approved, and we will move on to the report from our managing director. Good evening, Osmer, and welcome.
Thank you, Council President. Very briefly, last Friday was our going away event for Ralph Johnson. I'd like to thank the staff who showed up for that in our lunchroom. Someone who served the city 14 years faithfully deserved that. And I'd like to thank Councilwoman Donna Reed for showing up and being a council support in that event. Secondly, I would like to note that the administration has been working again with Councilwoman Donna Reed. It seems to be my report seems to be Councilwoman Donna Reed night on a parking situation near Northwest School. That will continue tomorrow as we try to resolve that issue there. Lastly, the administration's holding a morale boost event this Friday for the employees, a holiday event. And that's the conclusion of my report.
All right, thank you, Osmer. Any comments or questions for the managing director? All right, if there are none at this time, thank you for the report. We're going to move on to the report from the interim auditor. Good evening, Maria. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good evening. My report tonight, 2019 emission fee tax as of October 31st. For the current fiscal year, the city budgeted $500,000, and as of October 31st of this year, the city has received $308,583.23, which is the lowest amount of revenue received compared to the same period of time of the previous 4 years. My second report will be on real estate transfer tax. As so, 11/30/2019, for any property sold in the city, received 3.5% of the value of the real estate transfer, unless the property is a tax exempt. For the month of November of the current year, the city has received $330,855.79. Which is already exceeding the budget expectation by $394,086.51. This is my report for tonight, and I'm open for questions.
All right, thank you, Maria. Any comments or questions for the interim auditor? Go ahead, Johanny.
Thank you, Maria, for your report. Any idea why the admission fee taxes are so low compared to prior years?
If you look, the Santander Arena for in 2019, as of October 31st, we have received only $127,000. If you look the chart that is provided on the report, the previous year, you know, we bring in less money from the Santander Arena and the Performer Arts Center, as well from the Reading Royals. The Reading Phillies has been pretty consistent for the last from the previous 4 years. So that's mean less events at the Santander Arena and the Performer Arts Center. And because the Reading Royals was so like in June of this year, there's still money off from the previous owner. At this point, we're not sure if we're gonna get that revenue or not. I know I talked to Osmer this morning about that. It's still in delegation, I believe. So, but we already, I already provided the information to Osmer, and I know he have been following up with the previous owner.
All right, any other comments or questions for the auditor? Interim auditor? All right, if not, thank you, Maria, for the report.
You're welcome.
We are going to move on to a report from the department directors, boards, and authorities and commissions. This evening we have a brief report from Fire Chief Stout.
We won't let him, Chief. Good evening, members of council. One of the things that's been part of my duties is to provide you an annual report. And in 2016 and 17, I failed to get this report done. I didn't give it the priority that it should get. And even somewhat, this report that's coming around to you is our 2018 annual report. While delayed, it got done here. So that's where we're at. So I'll be brief and just doing an overview as the information's in there. There may not, the MD already received a copy of it, so I think we'll be good there. Pretty much what this does is it provides you with an overview of the departmental response information statistics for both fire and EMS. In 2018, the fire units responded 10,536 calls, of which roughly 58% of those were EMS related. The EMS units themselves responded to 19,456 calls. One of the things I know, and we spoke in the CAL, that Councilwoman Goodman Hinderschutz has been looking for is some stats on the naloxone events and all, which we just started more accurately compiling in 2019. So next year I'll have more of that. But even just looking at them roughly, they range anywhere from 11 in 1 month to like 32 in a month is what we've been seeing so far this year. Also in this report, there'll be some information there that'll give you, you know, some other departmental stats along with multiple alarm incidents that we had, and it'll give you an overview of the capital and grant projects that we were able to complete in 2018. Along with that, there's a section from the Fire Marshal's office that'll give you an update as the accomplishments of his office in 2018. That would include like their educational classes that they go out and do with the schools, their own education, code enforcement, and fire investigations incidents that they also use Gracie with. That's pretty much a summary as the information's there for you. As you're all aware, I cannot, and use all, I've shown your appreciation for the outstanding job that the guys in the department do. So thank you for your support as well throughout the years and all.
All right, thank you, Chief. Are there any comments or questions for the Chief at this time? You'll certainly have time to digest the report and follow up. Go ahead, Brian.
I just want to thank you on behalf of myself, and I'm sure Council will do the same, on your leadership, Chief. I think you've done a great job, and we of course want to thank you and your whole department for all the work you do to keep our city safe, keep our residents safe, and provide a fine service to our community. So without looking at too closely at that annual report, I just want to say thank you for your hard work.
Thank you, Councilman. Your sentiments are appreciated by myself and the department.
Lucy?
Chief, I look forward to reading through the annual report, possibly over the holidays, and digesting this good information. I think what strikes me the most is an appreciation of you and your departments and everybody that you work with is some of the smaller things that I see on a day-to-day basis. And especially when I've seen you come out to every single community meeting that I alone have had this year, engaging with citizens directly face-to-face. Annual reports are important, but so is basic conversation with the people that we serve in our city. So thank you very much for doing
Thanks.
That.
Thanks.
All right, Marcia?
And I think my utmost thanks to the professionalism and the high-quality services of the firefighters, the EMS workers. We're renowned throughout the county. They respect the work that's done in the city of Reading. And I think you're challenged by the type of structures we have, the access to them, some of the blighted properties, and everything that I've seen in my neighborhood has always been handled excellently, that, you know, their lives are considered, their value of their property is considered, so very much appreciated. And I know, at least for myself, next year we'll be looking at what you need as far as capital projects with the two fire stations. Okay, so for me, that's at the top of the list to make sure that we do what we need to do to make sure you have the right type of facilities to be able to have your equipment in, and that it's also better for the public too.
Thank you, and I will be coming for your support and all next year. So thank you all, and again, can't say enough about the job that the guys do out there. So,
all right, thank you, Chief. Thank you for the report. Okay, Council, we're going to move on to ordinances for final passage. The first bill this evening is Bill 50-2019, authorizing the transfer of $25,000 from Law Legal Services to the Charter Board to cover their expenses up to October 31st of this year. This was introduced at the October 28th regular meeting, tabled at the November 12th and November 25th regular meetings. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Lucine.
So this committee has been, or the Charter Board has been very active, and we had asked really for a breakdown of the expenditures. We had received that breakdown, which was very important for us to see where the money is being spent and how that's being spent. So I appreciate that so that we can better inform ourselves in making these decisions.
All right. Any other comments? Marcia?
And I believe we're going to be looking forward to be able to look at expenses and be able to have a sense of how this will be looking moving forward. And just like we do with any other department, I can support this, though, because I do feel it's needed to cover expenses that have been documented.
All right. Any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmer, seconded by Councilor Zelnick, to enact Bill Number 50-2019, which authorizes a transfer of $25,000 to the Charter Board to cover their expenses up to October 31st. Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henrichitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorow?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Zelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 56-2019, the 2020 real estate tax rate with no rate millage change from 2019. This was introduced at the September 30th special meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Donna.
I'm just really glad this was able to be accomplished with the work of the administration and with council. Our folks need as much of a break as they can. They already pay exorbitant amounts in income tax and personal income tax in terms of property transfer taxes, things like that. So I'm glad that we are not burdening them with additional taxes, and that we're able to maintain a strong workforce and even buoy up our police department a bit. So I know this is probably unrealistic for this to continue many years down the road, but I'm glad this year at least we've seen it occur.
All right, any other comments? Marcia?
And this is the first of a series of bills that we'll be considering that have to do with the 2000 20 budget. And I think what's important is that when we started out this process, there was a millage increase. There was some scrutiny as far as projected revenues and projected expenditures, and the administration was able to come back to us with the approval of Gordon Mann to be able to say that we did not need to have a tax increase. What I think is important to note, when we're looking at property tax, we have to also look at what the state now is beginning to do to look at school property tax, because basically for the homeowner, it comes out of the same pocket, whether it be in the municipality or the school district, and we need to cooperate and collaborate with them regarding this. And we also need to look at how we can keep this tax under control. I know it was put out that projections is we may not need to raise it. We have to be looking at our budget and planning ahead to make sure it stays at zero, and how we work with the school district to be able to look at how they can also keep that under control. One of the challenges we have with property tax being one of our taxing sources is that we have a lot of non-taxable properties. Being the county seat, having a large number of schools, other non-taxable properties in the city challenges us. So it's a real formula. So I can support this, but I also think we need to really continue to move ahead to look closely at what this looks like in the future.
All right, any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to enact Bill Number 56, 2019, which authorizes the 2020 real estate tax rate with no millage change. Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Sahelnik?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 57-2019, the 2020 commuter tax rate. This was introduced at the September 30th special meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? If there are no comments, then can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz, seconded by Councilor Sahelnik, to enact the 2020 commuter tax rate. Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Sahelnik?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 58-2019, the 2020 position ordinance. This was introduced at the September 30th special meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Marcia?
Yeah, I think it's just important to note that there were recommended positions in this. I don't know whether either Jamar or Osmer can just highlight what some of the positions were that we were, especially the ones I think that were under our discussions.
Good evening. I apologize. I don't have my budget book with me, but some of the positions that the administration put forward include a sustainability coordinator, a capital projects manager, to help get some of our significantly delayed projects off the ground, as well as some investments in a fifth EMS unit in the fire department, potentially 4 new officers in the police department, as well as a recruitment and training coordinator in the HR department, and then lastly, a communications director out of the managing director's office that services the whole city and all of its entities.
All right, thank you. Jamar, are there any other comments?
I just wanted to add one comment for both this and the budget, that this is available on the city website in all the complete documentation, so the public can know what we voted on, and that if there are any questions that they want to be asking for us. But I just I thank you for the in-depth job and the fact that you were willing to be able to work with us to be able to come to a balance so we could have both position ordinance and a budget that was ready to adopt.
All right, If there are no other comments, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Cepeda Freitas, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 58, 2019, which enacts the 2020 position ordinance. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Shalnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
So the next ordinance, we're going to have to go through an amendment to accept the budget as amended. So we're going to move this forward, and then we want to just kind of amend it to receive the actual amended budget as received. So let's move this forward first. The ordinance is 59-2019, the 2020 general budget. This was introduced at the September 30th special meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any recommendations, dissent, or comments?
Would the recommendation be to amend the budget as accept the amendments to the budget as received from the administration?
Okay.
Second.
Is there a second to that? Mm-hmm. Any comments on the amendments at this point?
Was that Donna?
Yeah, it was Donna.
I think the comment is that we did go through these very carefully and had a lot of good discussion, and also looked at some of the recommendations, how we need to plan for implementation. So it's not a matter of just passing the budget with the dollar amounts, it's how are we gonna make this happen working with the administration. Right. So I just wanna thank everyone for the work that was put into this. It was sometimes a painful process, but I also thought it showed good dialogue between the members of council and the administration.
Any other comments on the amendments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call on the amendment motion?
Bill Number 59, 2019, moved by Councilor Goodman-Henschitz, seconded by Councilor Reed, to accept the amendment as presented by the administration of the 2020 budget. Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Sahelnick?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henschitz?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
So the budget is now back on the table as amended. So is there any comments on the amended budget overall? If not, I'll just make a brief comment. I want to thank Marcia as the finance chair and the administration for working through, which is always a complicated process. It's an important process. It's the operands, if you will, of the city in the coming year. Our first priorities are always public safety, fire and police protection, but there's so much more that goes into city government. For anybody to sit through the first few budgets, you really get to see how in-depth it can be. And you know, the city does a lot of good things in a lot of areas, from capital expenditures to the Animal Rescue League, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, protecting the stray animals and trying to do what we can. So it is not an easy process, and I just want to thank everyone for getting through it. Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Henschitz, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 59, 2019, the 2020 budget as amended. Ms. Sahelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 60-2019, the 2020 capital budget, introduced at the September 30th special meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Marcia?
Lucy, do you want to make the comment first?
Sure. You know, it's really important that the capital budget has reached the point where it has. I want to thank the administration and Jamar, this process this year. It's been efficient. It's been effective. The capital budget is somewhere we need to pay astute attention to see much more movement this upcoming year, to prioritize projects effectively, to hand off to our potentially new capital improvements project manager to execute what we really need to do as a city. So thanks for making that process easier and creating it and preparing it for this new position so that this time next year we'll be eager to move us forward again.
Additional comments? Marcia?
Yeah, I believe that this capital budget is very much needed, all the projects. It's very aggressive, but I believe with the proper personnel in place, we should be able to move through. So we'll be having a lot of activity during this year approving these projects as they move forward through the bidding process and such. But I think our constituents will be very pleased to see by the end of next year as we start moving ahead. And some things take time, some things take more than a year, that we'll be seeing some progress for things that may have been deferred, but now we're ready to move forward.
Any other comments? So a couple points. I agree with the council members. The city is really investing in our playgrounds and our streets, and I want to commend the administration. Though we didn't launch a lot of these projects last year, we have them staged in the queue, and I believe we will have more success next year. But for the people who live in the city and outside the city, if you really take a look at this plan on the website, you'll see that there's a really good focus on improving a lot of our infrastructure. And that's very important. I when we talked about the budget, I forgot to mention, you know, we have a lot of tenure on the body, a lot of older council members, but a lot of newer ones who have really helped the process along by asking a lot of good questions, including in the capital budget. That's how we really, you know, keep this process improving, by bringing new eyes and new thoughts and challenging things. And so I think that really worked out well this year. So I just wanted to make that point. If there are no other comments on the general, on the capital budget, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Salnick, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 60, 2019, to enact the 2020 capital budget. Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Salnick?
Yes.
Mr. Kleinman?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, our next ordinance is Bill Number 61-2019, authorizing the transfer of $33,100 from the Public Works General Fund administration budget to contracted services to general fund, from contracted services to general fund maintenance repairs property. This was introduced at the November 12th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Pretty standard protocol to shift money around in public works, depending on the need. If there are no other comments, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmaru, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 61, 2019, to authorize a transfer from Public Works General Fund to maintenance, repairs, and property. Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Salnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 62-2019, authorizing an increase in the pay rate for police academy instructors from $30 an hour to $35 an hour. Last increase was approved in 2001. This was introduced at the November 12th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? We've seen none.
I'm happy to see this in effect. This should have occurred last year, and I believe this is one step of many that we can encourage for the police academy and the instructors and teachers for eventual retention of the officers who are potentially coming through this academy, and they can be inspired by motivated instructors and teachers.
Donna?
I agree with everything Lucine said. I also think it's interesting to see that it's taken all these years for them to just get a $5 an hour increase. These are very important people who are training our police officers and are training them in ways to deal with a very incredibly dangerous and challenging profession, and certainly a fair wage, and maybe it's something to even consider in another year, looking at the cost of living increase of what $30 an hour was in 2001 to what it will be in 2020. Maybe I think it would be time to revisit it again next year. To be fair, to be equitable.
All right, thank you. Are there any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Cepeda Freitas, seconded by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitz, to enact Bill Number 62, 2019, which authorizes a pay increase for the Police Academy instructors. Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Zelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 63-2019, amending the City Code Section 467-103 to freeze the annual increase in sewer rates to allow for a rate study to be completed to determine the rates necessary to pay for the capital improvement bonds for the wastewater plant, sanitary sewer, and MS4 projects. This was introduced at the November 25th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? I'll just make a brief comment. We did have a previous rate study when there were projections of higher costs and higher financing costs. This temporarily suspends this rate from year to year because they were inflated due to lower construction costs and lower financing costs, including a PennVest loan of $100 and some million at 1%. So our public works employees tell us as we get near the end of the completion of the wastewater treatment plant project and the subsequent projects demanded by the consent decree, we will be able to better identify the need to the amount of capital we need to pay down, and that will impact the rates moving forward. So it's a lot said, but just to give a little bit of an explanation. So Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman Hinderschitz, seconded by Councilor Marmaru, to enact Bill Number 63-2019 to amend the City Code Section 467-103 to freeze the annual increase in sewer rate. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Zelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Okay, our final ordinance for passage this evening is authorizing the purchase of the former Dana South site for the amount of $1,547,000. This was introduced at the November 25th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Before I open it up for comments, I just will state that the property, the will of the body was expressed to purchase the property. There were some concerns that the ordinance was memorialized appropriately, so we're going back to assure that the proper documentation was in place. But the transaction was voted on and approved by City Council with a clear understanding. So any other comments? All right, if there are none, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman Hinderschitz, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to enact Bill Number 64-2019, which authorizes the purchase of the Dana South property. Ms. Zelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
No.
Ms. Goodman Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
6 yeas, 1 nay.
All right, we have one ordinance for introduction this evening. I'm going to ask the Councilwoman Marcia Goodman Hinderschitz to please read that onto the record.
Okay, A, ordinance amending the City Code, Chapter 180, Construction Codes, Part 6, International Mechanical Code, Sections 180 to 602, by reducing the number of board members from 9 to 7 and changing the definition of a quorum to a majority of the members present.
Thank you, Marcia. We're going to move on to resolutions. Our first resolution this evening is 109-2019, appointing Nigel Walker to the Historical Architectural Review Board. Is there a motion, please?
Move to table.
There's a motion to table. There's a second to table. There's no comment on a table motion. So, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Reed, seconded by Councilor Marmaru, to table Resolution 109-2019. Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
No.
Ms. Goodman Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Pardon?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Zelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
6 yeas, 1 nay.
All right, our next resolution is 110-2019, appointing Sandy Graffius to the Audit Committee. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Marcia?
Yeah, just for clarity, when we set up the audit committee, we felt it was very imperative to have a representative from the county to be sitting on that. It makes perfect sense to have the county auditor in that position. That's Mrs. Grafius. I was the only person that interviewed her, but I think a lot of you are familiar with her work and such. It was pointed out to me at our committee of the whole that people have been moved forward with only one member of the nominations committee doing the interviews. I was not 100% comfortable with that with either of the candidates, but knowing the background and the person, that this person is the person we need. And I just want to thank her for her patience in having us go through the process we needed to. And I really look forward to, and I know Maria and I serve on that audit committee together with Jamar and other city staff. This will be a real asset. And we're ready to roll as far as what we need to do. It's good to have some outside eyes looking at our city financials.
All right, are there any other comments on this resolution? If not, oh, Donna.
And I'll just back up everything Marcia said. I mean, the added joy is that Sandy is one of Lucene's not just neighbors, but constituents. So she is a Reading resident. And I can say from 30 plus years of knowing Sandy Grafius, from covering her in my business writing and editing days to working with her on some county and other issues, she's just a really tremendous person who has both background in the private sector as well as the public sector, and I think she'll be a real asset to you guys. She's a very engaged individual and a very, very smart individual, so it's a pleasure to support her.
All right, are there any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councillor Zelnick, seconded by Councillor Goodman-Henderschitz to adopt Resolution 110, 2019, which appoints Sandy Grafius to the Audit Committee. Ms. Peter Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Zelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next resolution is authorizing the submission of the Pennsylvania DCED CFA H2O Pennsylvania High Hazard Dams and High Hazard Unsafe Dams grant for the lower dam at Eggleman's Park at a total cost of $612,500, requesting $367,500 from the state. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Marcia?
Okay. This is a real joy to have this move forward. Eggleman's Park and Eggleman's Dam is one of the jewels of the city that's sometimes unrecognized. And the fact that the dam needed to be replaced according to state requirements, the city could not afford the total cost. This grant will be very helpful. And with suggestions from the community, the dam is going to be lowered, but it will still allow the bass, not the trout, like I said at the last meeting, but the bass to be reinstituted as a hatchery. So I'm just very pleased for everyone that may question, this is still in the city of Reading, okay? It's not in Lower House, it's just right on the border. Again, a beautiful asset. It was incorrectly expressed by one of the speakers as far as contamination. This dam site has no issues of contamination. It's just the structure of the dam needed to be addressed.
All right, are there any other comments?
Yeah. Lucy? I want to thank the Public Works Department and any other part of the administrative team that expedited and focused on this as a priority. The dams are a priority for the city. Here we can see, hopefully, that we move forward with Eggleman's in hopes that next year we can continue to address the other two that are also a continued priority for our city.
All right. Any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councillor Cepeda Freitas, seconded by Councillor Goodman-Henderschitz, to adopt Resolution 124, 2019, which authorizes the grant application for Eggleman's Lower Dam. Oops. Ms. Goodman-Henderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Zelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Cepeda Freitas?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President.
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, our final resolution is authorizing the execution of a 3-year contract with the Animal Rescue League for animal control services at the annual cost of $2 per citizen based on a 2010 U.S. Census data. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
We'd be removing everything in 2000. All right, any comments?
Yeah, I'd like to thank Maritza Loiza from my office and helping work with this. I'd like to thank the Animal Rescue League for coming to City Hall, bringing this to my attention, and I bring this to a point where we can continue the relationship with the ARL, the safety and care of the animals in the city.
Any other comments? Lucine.
Yeah, I want to, thank the Animal Rescue League. The animal control services that they provide are very important, not only to our city, but to our county. And so really what I would like to ask is a call to action for the other municipalities to consider this as they move forward so we can continue to support the work that the ARL does.
Yep. Any other comments? And I agree with Lucine. We encourage the other municipalities, the city with all its requirements that it has in its lap, still finds the room to make sure we look out for the animals in our city, including the fish. Didn't even think of that one.
Yeah,
and the frogs and the snakes and the turtles, but a lot of cats and dogs, of course, in the city, so we need the services. But it's good that we do look after them as best we can. So. Are there any other comments? Go ahead, Marcia.
And I think just to remember, and I was reminded this as I was driving home tonight, there are animals that need to be adopted, okay? So if you have a place in your heart and a place in your home for another pet or know someone else, it's sometimes not the best to do it right around Christmas because of all the craziness that goes on, but just think about how you might be able to take a pet into your home. I know that these animals give a lot of love back for the love that you give them, and it really helps the Animal Rescue League not to have as many animals to shelter at one time.
All right, if there are no other comments, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Twyman, seconded by Councilor Reed, to adopt Resolution 123-2019, which authorizes the adoption of the ARL contract. Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Helnick?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Pater Freitas?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, Council, we're down to our final order of business, and that would be Council comments. Does anybody have any issues they want to discuss this evening? We'll go with Lucine and then Donna.
Just a general note of thanks. There's so much going on this time of year as we approach the end of the year and look forward to celebrating a new year. Things are significant in our responsibilities as passing a budget. Obviously, our priority.
Those are separate now.
But it needs to also be noted that the work that the community members do at this time of year is just as important. All various types of celebrations, supporting each other, donations. For example, this past weekend we had a lovely inaugural event in the south side of the city at the Reading Iron Playground. So as much as we do our work here, it's important to acknowledge and celebrate all the work that is happening throughout our beautiful city as we work together to celebrate all of the holiday traditions that are coming upon us and move into a bright new happy 2020 year.
Thank you, Lucine. Donna?
Okay, just a few things. The Center Park House Tour, the annual holiday house tour was yesterday, and Johanny, that's your district. I hope you don't mind me mentioning it. I've been either a part of this or volunteering it for 30-odd years now, and every year it's totally delightful, totally fun, a little bit added to it with the moonlight tour the night before, and then with the brunch and the tour that day. They had a good day, and it was a good attendance. Made a little sad, of course, because at the Feeney Funeral Home was the visitation for young Anthony Myers of Berks Catholic, who passed because of a brain tumor. Everyone certainly had their hearts there, as well as in the beauty of those houses. So it was a bittersweet day, but it was a good day for everyone to support each other, both in the aesthetic part of a house tour, as well as the spiritual part of what occurred with that young man, which should never happen to anyone at that age. So our thoughts are certainly with them. Also with Center Park, Jahani, again, your district is doing good stuff. The Artifacts Bank has have a 50% off sale this weekend. All the money goes right back into the city, into the district. So if you need a door, if you need a bathtub, there are some really interesting things at the Artifacts Bank right now. Among them are two lime green circa 1920, 1930 toilets that belong to Max Hassel, who was quite the legend in the days of, what would you call it, gangsters in Reading, yep. Mob in Reading. Mm-hmm. So anyhow, if you want to experience, I guess, what he did, there are two lime green kidney-style toilets there. So you never know what happens in Reading. Mm-hmm. So on other notes, on Thursday at 1 o'clock is the ribbon cutting for the Penn Street Bridge. Hopefully a lot of us will be there. I serve on the Reading Area Transportation Study Committee. And I want to shout out to Carol Snyder, our former managing director. She and I worked together and lobbied very hard for the under-tier lighting on that bridge. And I'm really glad to see it. It really reflects on the river, and it's beautiful. And as it leads to your gateway, Jahani, with the businesses and everything on Penn Street, it's been great. There's a groundbreaking also on Friday morning at the Humane Society, which is certainly a good partner in animal welfare along with the ARL. And so that is at 10 o'clock on Friday morning. Friday afternoon, Incorporation Day, 150 years of the Berks History Center, also known as Historical Society of Berks County. Jahani, you have the main building, I have the library, so we share that. District 5 and 6 share that. So I'm hoping a lot of our fellow counselors can be there to enjoy that day. And Jeff, I think we need to declare that Incorporation Day in Reading, so maybe you need to do a little certificate for that. All right. If possible. And then finally, I'm going to use a Grumman's prerogative and wish a happy third birthday to our little 18th wonder, Hunter, who is one of Lucene's youngest constituents. So that's being a grandma. I have to say that, Hunter, I missed your little party today, so I'm sorry.
Okay, any other comments? Marcia?
First, I want to, and this is more on a sober note, but I want to thank our Reading EMS department, who worked together with West Reading and other municipalities. Unfortunately, we've had a string of tragic overdoses over the weekend. I believe, from what I read, there were 12 people that overdosed, 3 that passed, and I just really know that it's the hard work of the EMS, the police departments, to keep these folks alive. So I was dismayed by some of the comments people made, that they don't understand that this opioid crisis is an addiction, that people need to have the help and support. So hopefully those that have survived this and have been treated at our local hospitals will be connected to the treatment resources. But again, I know our guys and gals go above the call of duty when they were able to resuscitate those folks, so thank you for that. This is a really busy time up at the Reading Pagoda, the holiday season. This Saturday, Santa Claus will be up at the Pagoda greeting children, and then you can have breakfast with Santa and pictures and such. Of course, on the 24th, Santa flies over the city of Reading, so look at 9 o'clock at night. The lights of the pagoda will flash as a tradition, and people do join us up there for that. It's really a festive type of holiday season, hopefully the weather allows. And then, of course, December 31st, New Year's Eve, we will be having the pagoda open with live music, Dave Klein Trio, starting at 10 o'clock till midnight, and then we have the traditional fireworks. So, Chief Stout, I'm hoping the weather is good. We don't have any wind up there, and we can have the fireworks going on and enjoy the festivities. So just look out for other things. And I just also want to thank our local churches and our faith-based organizations for doing so much over the holiday season. Breakfast with Santa, they've just been everywhere I look, there's something happening. Thank you.
All right, any other comments? If not, our meeting schedule is as follows. We have, there's the Pentry Bridge ribbon cutting at 1 o'clock on Thursday on the city side of the bridge. On Monday, December 16th, we're gonna have a Finance Committee of the Whole in the Penn Room at 5 o'clock. On Monday, December 23rd, we have the Committee of the Whole in the Penn Room at 5 o'clock. And then we have our regular meeting of councils back here, of council back here in council chambers at 7 o'clock. If there's no other business, can we have a motion to adjourn? We're adjourned, thank you. Linda, we didn't have to sign the budget ordinances or anything?
No.
3A.
I did. Oh, yeah. Earlier. Gotcha. Nice of you.
That's okay.
Right, no, that one. People want that.